present friend. We're back again with our friend Bill Palm, a retired judge, a crime novelist, a frequent contributor to Truth Out and LA Progressive and The Progressive. Just a real busy guy. So most recently, how are you doing, Bill?
I'm doing quite well. How are you guys?
We're good. So most recently, you wrote a really fine article about Strip Search Samuel Alito. I vaguely remember the story about the 10-year-old girl that had gotten strip searched. I didn't remember it was tied to Alito. Maybe you can tell us how he earned that name.
Okay, so there was a drug raid in Pennsylvania in 1998, and even though this child was not named as a subject of the search warrant, she wound up being strip searched under the theory that perhaps drugs were being concealed in her body. When the issue finally came to the DC Circuit Court of Appeals, where Alito was a judge, he wrote a dissenting opinion holding that the strip search was lawful within the meaning of the Fourth Amendment. This was a minority opinion, by the way. So he lost on that. But since then, as a result of that, he acquired the nickname Strip Search Sammy. And of course, on the Supreme Court, according to a recent academic study, he is the most pro-prosecution justice on the court. It's ironic that he seems to be coming to the aid of one particular defendant in the cases before the court today, and that defendant is Donald Trump.
Yeah, that's it's come to be very unsurprising that he continues to take that position. So let's talk a little bit about the character of Supreme Court Justice Samuel Alito. What's been in the news lately is this upside down flag flying bit. Can you talk to us about what you've written here in this article?
Sure. So recently it's come to light that Samuel Alito and his wife, Martha Ann, have flown two MAGA-themed flags. The first, an upside-down American flag at their Virginia home immediately after the January 6th insurrection, and the second, just last summer, a flag known as the Appeal to Heaven flag, which is a pine tree topped with the motto Appeal to Heaven outside their Long Beach Island, New Jersey vacation home. And Alito has denied any impropriety or involvement in the flying of those flags, even though in the first instance, there was a real brouhaha with some of his neighbors over the flying of the inverted American flag. And he's blamed it all on his wife. So this is in keeping with Samuel Alito's growing reputation as the most prickly, the most thin-skinned, and perhaps the most narcissistic of all the justices on the Supreme Court. Alito is nothing more and nothing less than a GOP partisan hack on the Supreme Court. So if I were asked to give a one-sentence job description or bio of Samuel Alito, it would be Republican activist, currently employed as a justice of the United States Supreme Court, and not the other way around. I think that he's even exceeded Clarence Thomas in terms of his open partisanship on the court. You know which way Sammy's going to vote when the chips are down. He will vote whatever way the Republican donors and the Trumpers want cases to be decided, even more than Clarence, which is saying a great deal. So with Clarence Thomas on the court, with Alito on the court, and the three Trump appointees, and then John Roberts, who is no friend of civil liberties, we have a court which for the foreseeable future has been captured by the hard right. I'm not saying that it's as bad as the hardcore MAGA caucus in Congress, but it's not a whole lot better, and it's nothing that we can rely on to protect our rights and our liberties any longer. So in this upcoming election, people should keep in mind, as they consider all of the issues, that if Donald Trump is reelected and justices step down from the court, Sotomayor is getting old in age, she has diabetes. If Thomas retires, he's getting up there in age, we're going to get more Sammy Alitos, more strip search Sammys on the court, more incompetent people, and more reliably hardcore GOP activists. So keep that in mind as you decide whether or not you're going to help Donald Trump get reelected in November, or you're going to vote for Joe Biden, even though he is far, far, far from perfect as a vehicle for upholding progressive values.
Yeah, I think that's important to point out that, yes, there are many reasons why we vote for a president, but really, one of the most important reasons is because the president has the power to appoint Supreme Court justices. And some might argue that Supreme Court justices wield more power than the other two branches of government, especially when you consider that Alito shows no shame in his game. I mean, he just does what he wants, and there are no checks and balances.
Well, way back in the 1840s, the French philosopher, political philosopher, Alexis de Tocqueville, in his treatise, Democracy in America, said, sooner or later, every political question in America becomes a legal question. So that's true. The Supreme Court gets all of these major issues that affect the most intimate aspects of our lives, and it issues final, unreviewable decisions. Samuel Alito, of course, just to remind everyone, is the author of the Dobbs decision that struck down Roe. And he did so in a way which was very, very dishonest when you consider what he said at his 2005 confirmation hearing, his 2006 confirmation hearing, and where he said that Roe was a strong precedent of the Supreme Court, that it had been reaffirmed by the Supreme Court, and that when a decision gets reaffirmed several times by the Supreme Court, that strengthens its value as settled law. As I said in the article, he was plainly lying, because in the Dobbs decision, he wrote that Roe was egregiously wrong from the start. Its reasoning was weak, and it had dangerous consequences for the country. That was his belief at the time of this confirmation hearing in 2006. It remained his belief throughout his period on the Supreme Court. And now, because he has allies in the Trump Three, and that's all he needed. All we needed to change Roe was to change the composition of the court. Nothing else changed. And now Roe, a woman's right for 49 years, is now off the books, and we have the chaos that we're seeing across the country with women being denied the right to terminate pregnancies, the right to reproductive health care, resulting in very serious health consequences, and giving rise to this idea that there was that women were just getting abortions frivolously, like they would be taking Advil for a headache. It's just ushered in the worst kinds of consequences. And Alito doesn't care. And why doesn't he care? Because he has lifetime tenure. And there's no real judicial code of ethics binding the Supreme Court, even though they adopted one in recent months. It's just a fig leaf. It's unenforceable. They enforce the ethics concepts all by themselves. And again, there's no one to review them.
So I find it remarkable or sad that most or all of the right-wing justices that you cited came out of, at some point in their previous careers, came directly out of the Republican Party or off the staff of a Republican administration. And that's much less true of the liberal justices. Certainly they had their liberal bona fides, but they didn't work directly for the Democratic Party. That's a part of what's gotten us in this pickle, right?
That's right. I mean, with the exception of Kagan, who was Solicitor General, she was part of the government. But it is true. Ever since Robert Bork's failed confirmation hearing in the 1980s, the Republican nominees, and for the most part, they are Republican nominees. We haven't had a Democratic majority on the Supreme Court for decades, have learned a lesson. And that is, don't be too candid about what you really believe when you go through these Senate confirmation hearings so that you can garner a majority and get yourself on the court. And then once you're on the court, you can agitate and deliberate in ways that move the law in the direction that you really desire. And it is a sad commentary on our political system. And again, you know, people on this program hear that I'm advocating a vote for Joe Biden, and I am, because Joe Biden is the lesser of two evils, a great evil in Donald Trump. But that's not to say that Joe Biden's this perfect candidate. And in terms of the Supreme Court, we can thank Joe Biden for the confirmation of Clarence Thomas, because Joe Biden, after Anita Hill testified, was singularly responsible for preventing three or four other women who had accused Clarence Thomas of similar sexual improprieties from testifying in person before the Judiciary Committee. Had he not done that, I think Thomas would not have been confirmed. Because that was a time when even the Republican Party cared about those sorts of behaviors. But they don't anymore. I mean, look at the reaction to Donald Trump's conviction in the Alvin Bragg prosecution. The Republican Party's rallying around Donald.
But one big difference between Donald and Clarence Thomas is that Clarence Thomas is a Black man. And believe you me, they do care about that. So
that's correct.
What Donald Trump gets away with, Clarence Thomas would never get away with.
So you conclude by saying, you know, what in heaven's name can we do about Samuel Alito, Clarence Thomas? I mean, they have lifetime tenure, and they are pretty obviously thumbing their nose at their opponents or the public. Even John Roberts, in a way, is thumbing his nose by saying, it's beyond his job to discipline the others. And the best we can do is maybe us a long-term project, pack the court, which seems unlikely, or just keep the heat on them. But do you think keeping the heat on people like Samuel Alito will make a difference?
Well, I think that Samuel Alito is very attuned to public criticism. He hates public criticism. He has a feud with one of the writers for The Atlantic magazine, a guy named Adam Server. They actually go back and forth. And Alito wrote an op-ed for The Wall Street Journal defending his interview with some journalists, one of whom was a lawyer who presented a case in front of him. So I think that criticizing the court does have some marginal, tangible benefits, and we have to keep it up. We have to criticize the justices in the same way we criticize politicians. And I do think on the margins that does help. I think that it's moved John Roberts in certain cases to join with the liberals. I think that it has moved, or seems to be moving, Amy Coney Barrett to join a little bit with the liberals. In various cases. If you look at the case that tried to take Trump off the ballot under the 14th Amendment's insurrection clause, that was really a 5-4 decision rather than a 9-0 decision, if you really read it carefully. And Barrett wrote a concurring opinion, as did the three liberals, saying that the court went too far. I think we should keep our eye on Barrett for the two remaining abortion decisions that are on this court's docket for this term, the one with the abortion pill and the other with the emergency care provision for abortion services that comes out of Idaho, and see where she winds up in that divide. So I do think public criticism works at the margins, But really what we have to do is make sure that we elect presidents who, when there are vacancies, are not going to fill them with Samuel Alitos. You know, I was never a Hillary fan, but if we had elected Hillary Clinton, we wouldn't have these, we wouldn't have Gorsuch, Kavanaugh, and Barrett.
Right.
We simply wouldn't have them.
Oh,
and Roe would still be the law.
Yeah, yeah. But one thing we haven't discussed is that we have another tool in our toolbox. But sadly, it seems like we don't have the kind of democracy, the kind of participatory, fully engaged populace that understands that we actually can impeach him.
Well, you can, but there's such a high bar there with two-thirds in the Senate. You also have to work with Congress and elect a strong progressive majority, which will do two things. It can reduce the court's funding, which will hurt it, and it can also pass laws that change the appellate jurisdiction of the court, which is most of the court's jurisdiction, because if you read the Constitution, it's Congress that gets to define the appellate jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. So it can remove certain decisions from the court's purview. It can't change the original jurisdiction. These are cases which are brought as a matter of first time filing within the Supreme Court, but it can change the appellate jurisdiction of the court. So Congress has to get tough, but it's only going to get tough if we elect tough people. So it's not just the president, it's down ballot races too that count.
Absolutely. And I do want to also emphasize that, because there are some people that are talking about being so disillusioned with the two options that we have that they're not even going to show up. But one extremely important to remember is that we've got an entire down ballot ticket that has to be voted on. And it's very important, even pieces of legislation, initiatives, city council races, all of these things need more engagement from the population.
And it's not just voting. It doesn't mean, when I was younger, I thought, yes, voting is very critical, but most of the actions in the streets, with demonstrations, you can continue to do that.
Yes, that's right.
Just take time off to vote.
That's right.
It takes very little time in most jurisdictions to do that. Vote your interests.
Yeah, we talk about one of the key planks in the Powell memo, which led to many of the problems we have now, was involvement on the local level, at the city, at the PTA level, the city
school
council
board.
Level. But I must say that as outrageous as strip shirt Sammy is, he was not the big issue this week for some reason.
That's right. Because Donald John Trump went down, finally. He's being held to account in a criminal case. 34 felony charges. Returned guilty.
Thank you, Alvin Bragg.
That's right. Masterfully put on prosecution in this case. Unbelievable. It exceeded my expectations. I thought there'd be a conviction. But as the evidence was coming in, I said 60% chance. Then I saw how the Trump team put on its last witness, a lawyer named Robert Costello, and he imploded. And I went up to 70%. Then I heard the closing arguments or heard commentary about them. And I thought 75%, but I still didn't expect 34 convictions, unanimous convictions, beyond a reasonable doubt. And now we have them. And I think the early polling is showing that that's having an effect on Trump. Morning Consult, Reuters, Ipsos, all showing that this is having some tangible effect against Donald Trump and his bid to retake the White House. And so I think the message to get out is that a second Trump term would be a disaster for everyone we care about. Read his interview with Time magazine. Read what Mike Johnson, the Speaker of the House, wants to do with an omnibus bill if they win the White House and they win back the House, to revamp the federal government. You can kiss a lot of your freedoms goodbye, and not just abortion. They're going to come after other rights, like the right to contraception. Of course, they're whittling away the right to vote. You're going to see attacks on unions. You're going to see tax cuts for the super rich. You're going to see public education just dry up. You're going to see protests smashed, not just by local police forces, but by the National Guard, and if necessary, by the U.S. military. If you think that the current establishment is tough on pro-Palestine demonstrations, you ain't seen nothing yet, as the old saying goes.
And I understand that he's even considering attacking Social Security.
That's right. Social Security is another one of those issues that's percolating within the right-wing legal movement as being unfounded under the Constitution, Social Security and Medicare. So they are very much in play, and people have to be aware of that. So it's important to walk and chew gum at the same time, keep the protests up, but also vote on November 5, and do not let Donald Trump get reelected, and vote locally.
Well, Bill Blum, it's such a pleasure talking to you again. I'm glad we had some good news.
We had some great news this week.
That's right.
Great news. And it's very heartening.
It is. Well, until next time, Bill Blum, we look forward to hearing some more of your pearls of wisdom.
Well, thank you.
So have a great week.
Thank you, Bill.
You too.
Thank you so much.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you for sticking around. If you like the LA Progressive content and the discussions we have here, please consider clicking the subscribe button below and also give us a thumbs up. That helps to grow our audience by feeding the algorithm, which helps to get this content in front of more eyes. Thanks for stopping by. We really appreciate your support.